sets my heart free. I will love you in the shadow and the light. I will trust you even when.
Love for me and how far would you run for me? healed by broken hands. In spite of all the obstacles, I've seen humble feet choose a dagger's end. Good morning, welcome to Springs. We're so glad you're here. I want to invite you to stand and sing with us. Come on. Let's sing it out together. There were walls.
There were walls between us. By the cross you came in broken down. You broke down. There were chains around us. By your grace we are no longer bound, no longer bound. You called me out of the grave, you called me into the light, you called my name in my heart.
we're just so grateful for your presence and that you are a God that pursues us, that chases after us, Father. We love you so much. We worship you. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Let's sing this out together. Before I spoke a
word, you were singing over me. You have been so good to me. For I took a breath, you breathe your life for me. You have been so kind to me.
Come on, sing it out.
Yeah.
It was so great to see you this morning. You guys can go ahead and have a seat.
Good morning. How's life? Y'all good? Welcome to Church of the Springs. My name's Hal Mayer, and I'm one of the pastors here, and you are one generous group. Do you know that? We gave over 4 tons of food to Interfaith. Is that good? That would feed my family for a week. So way to go, folks. Good job. It's July. How did that happen? This week, July. One of the cool things happening in July is you'll no longer need to reserve your seat, okay? I know a couple, your thumb's getting tired, right? But we've now managed to spread the crowds out over 3 services, and so we'll still do social distancing, but you won't have to reserve your seat. Would everybody right now reach in and pull out the Connect card? Looks like this. Maybe you're doing it digitally. You can go to thesprings.net/connect card and fill that in there. And as you fill that in, maybe you've got a prayer request. Maybe you've got an update in information. You can put that on there. And then later in the worship service, when we give, we'll ask you just to place that in the basket on your way out. All right? Well, welcome to week 3 of Won't You Be My Neighbor? Watch the screens.
It's a beautiful day in this neighborhood, a beautiful day for a neighbor. Would you be mine? Could you be mine? It's a neighborly day in this beauty wood, a neighborly day for a beauty. So let's make the most of this beautiful day. Since we're together, we might as well say, would you be mine? Could you be mine? Won't you be my neighbor? Won't you please? Won't you please? Please won't you be my neighbor?
What's going on, 9 o'clock? How you guys doing? Awesome. So good to be with you folks this morning. You look great. Well, happy Sunday to you and all of our locations. My name is Bryan, one of the teaching pastors on the team. So excited that you're here for week 3 of a series of talks we're doing this summer called Won't You Be My Neighbor? And one of the things we found in the last couple weeks is the best way to love your neighbor is to simply be a good neighbor. And so we're spending some time this summer figuring out what does it look like to love our neighbor by being a good neighbor. This week, I want to speak to you on the topic of coming to the table. And I know what you're wondering. You're thinking, is that fried chicken, those biscuits, are they real? Oh, they are, and it smells amazing. I should have eaten breakfast. Holy cow. You ever gone grocery shopping when you're hungry? It's kind of like that. Not a good idea. But we're going to have some fun this morning talking about coming to the table. You know, the table, I don't know how it was for you, but like when I was growing up, I'm from Chicago, and my family, our table, our dinner table was like a safe haven, man. It was a sanctuary. And I remember, like, my mom would make some amazing meals, some meatloaf, some spaghetti, some chicken fried something or other. Like, it was delicious. And I looked forward to every meal because my mom was a great cook. But I looked forward to every meal because of the people I was eating with, right? I felt like my family was safe. And how many of y'all, like, your family just gets crazy over the dinner table? Like, anybody get crazy? Like, some families, I think, like, have these nice, peaceful, quiet dinners together. And, like, to each their own, that was not my family. My family, we could get loud, we could get crazy, we would laugh, and it was always a wonderful time. And I cannot overemphasize the fact that I felt safe at the kitchen table. Any of y'all know what I'm talking about? And I needed that because school for me growing up was difficult. Some of you have heard my story, and you know that I grew up with a very severe case of Tourette's syndrome, attention deficit hyperactive disorder, and obsessive compulsive disorder, in addition to a number of learning disabilities and such. And so for me, coming home at the end of the day, it was like, oh, after just feeling like I was never enough in school, it was so nice to come home and have dinner with my family around the family table. But that wasn't the only reason. See, when I was in elementary school, heading into middle school, I was bullied on a pretty regular basis. And I don't know if you were ever bullied. Like, bullying was much different back then as it is now. Now it's like this weird passive-aggressive social media thing. Now, back then, it was just meet me at the bike rack. You remember this? And so there was this one kid, Danny Steele, who every day would make fun of me. He called me Tick Boy because of my Tourette's. And there came the point when I just got sick of it. Like, mama didn't raise no punk. And so I said, it's time to meet up at the bike rack. And so we arranged a time after school. And, you know, everyone in the schoolyard finds out it's happening. And so they gather around to, you know, tell you why you shouldn't. That's a lie. Everyone's like, fight, you know, and they're coming around. So we get together at the bike rack, and he just sort of like backs me into a corner. He's threatening me. He's calling me names. And frankly, I know he's just trying to humiliate me in front of my classmates. And finally, I just got sick of it. And so I clocked him as hard as I could right in the face. His glasses went flying. They broke. He couldn't see. Now he's grasping. Now that's right at the very time when the principal came outside and sees this happen. And all the principal sees is the fact that I punched this guy, his glasses broke, and now he can't see. So I look like the bad guy. So who gets in trouble for this fight? I do, of course. The victim in this bullying relationship was me up until this point. I'm the one who gets in trouble. So I go home and I tell my parents, this is injustice. This is not fair. And we're sitting at the family table, which of course for me, like I said, was a sanctuary. It was a safe haven. And I'm just unloading on my parents about how awful the events of this day were. And my parents said, well, we will talk about it. We'll discuss this. We'll get in touch with the principal and we'll figure out how to proceed from here. So they did. Day or two later, my parents come to me and say, Bryan, we think we found a solution. I said, awesome, because justice needs to be served. We cannot go on any longer as we have been. And so finally, we are putting our foot down. Mom and Dad, what do you have in mind? They said, we're inviting him to dinner. I said, say what? We're indicting him as a sinner? No, we're inviting him to dinner. I said, that's literally the worst idea I've ever heard, ever. Why would we do that? This is a safe place. This is a sacred place. Why would we invite a bully to dinner? And so we just think, you know, maybe if we invite him to dinner, like your relationship might change, you know, forgiveness and reconciliation might come about. And I said, how? And they said, we don't know, but let's see. See, what my parents understood was this. Who you eat with is just as important, if not more important, than what you're eating to begin with. Like, who you put around the table is incredibly important. So we have him over, we have this meal. It's incredibly awkward, as you might imagine, but somehow from this meal, and to this day, I cannot articulate to you exactly how or when something shifted, but somehow because of that dinner, Danny and I ended up becoming best friends. I figure that. We started a Christian rock band. We toured all over our neighborhood playing in garages and basements. Super awesome. Band was called Aunt Martha. Look us up on, yeah, we're nowhere. But like, I just remember this friendship evolving all because of one dinner table conversation. What is it about the table? There's something about the table, wouldn't you agree? There's something about a table that turns strangers into neighbors. There's something about the table that turns enemies into friends. When I look at the status of our nation right now, and I look at all the division and all the disagreements, all the conflict and all the wishful thinking that justice will come in some way or another, I just think, what if we could just get around the table more with people who aren't like us? What if we could just get around the table with people who we would want to say to them, won't you be my neighbor? I mean, this is what Jesus did. If you study his life and ministry, so much of his life was spent around a table, oftentimes with people who were unexpected, unqualified, and if we're being really honest, undeserving. There was one meal in particular that I want to take you to today, and that's the Last Supper. The Last Supper, when Jesus spread the table for some of his friends, you say, did it look like this? I don't know, probably not. Maybe it was southern Israel, fried chicken and biscuits. But like he spread the table for his friends. And here's what the Bible tells us in Luke's gospel took place. It says, when the time came, Jesus and the apostles sat down together at the table. Jesus says, I've been very eager to eat this Passover meal with you before my suffering begins. This was like a festival meal that would be celebrated annually. For I tell you now that I won't eat this meal again until its meaning is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. So look what he does here. He took a cup of wine and gave thanks to God for it. And then he said, take this and share it among yourselves, for I will not drink wine again until the kingdom of God has come. And then he takes some bread and gave thanks to God for it. And then he broke it into pieces, giving it to his disciples, saying, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And after supper, he took another cup of wine and said, this cup is the new covenant. What's a covenant? A covenant is a contractual agreement, like a way of relating to God. And what he's saying is there's this new way that we're going to be able to open up this relationship between God and man because of my body that's about to be broken, because my blood is about to be spilled for you. An agreement confirmed with my blood, which is poured out as a sacrifice for you. What is Jesus doing here? He's taking this meal that many of them were familiar with, that had this ancient symbolism dating all the way back to the Exodus. And he's saying, I'm assigning new symbolism, new meaning to it. Where now every time that you break this bread, you pour this wine, you'll think about me. You'll think about my body that was broken for you, my blood that was spilled for you, also that you can have a new relationship with God. Is anyone grateful for the cross? Is anyone grateful for Jesus, his broken body and spilled blood for us? Thank you, God, for the new covenant. But what's interesting to me about this text is not what they were eating, it's who Jesus was eating with. You see, this food, this wine, had powerful symbolism. It had powerful meaning, but none of that mattered if he didn't have the right people around the table with him. If you know the story of Jesus, you might know that throughout the duration, the 3 years of ministry, at the end of his life, he had 12 disciples. How many? Someone say 12? He had 12 followers that were kind of like his core, right? And he seats them around the table for this last supper. Now, I wish I had time this morning to go through all 12 of them, but I want to just talk about four. Like I said a moment ago, the people who are seated at the table with Jesus were often unexpected and undeserving of their seats. Let's look at four of them. And what I want you to do as I'm going through these this morning, look at me. I want you to consider who you relate to the most. Who around this table can you identify with based on their circumstances and their personality? First one is one who loved Jesus. One who loved Jesus. That's my boy John. You've probably heard of John before. John wrote the Gospel of John, one of the four witness accounts of Jesus' life and ministry. He also wrote 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John a little bit later on in the New Testament near the end of your Bible. And one of the predominant themes in all of those books is love. And that's because John was super confident that he was loved by Jesus. In fact, he even gave himself a nickname in his own gospel, the disciple who Jesus loved. Now, he doesn't say this about any of the other disciples. How do you think they felt, right? Well, why does John think that Jesus loves him more than the rest of us? Well, John was a part of this, not just group of 12 disciples, but also this inner core group of three, Peter, James, and John. They would often be invited into deeper miracles, deeper teaching, stuff that Jesus was doing that, watch this, the other nine did not get to be a part of. And I love how once you get to the end of John's gospel, he calls himself the disciple Jesus loved. Now, at first glance, don't miss this, at first glance, I have to admit that I thought, how arrogant. How arrogant that you would call yourself the disciple Jesus loved, but not refer to any of the other disciples as such. But then I started to wonder, well, maybe he just has a deeper confidence than I do that he is loved by Jesus, regardless of who he is or what he does. He is simply loved. How many of you know that if you're not careful, confidence can morph into cockiness? Such was the case for John. There was one occasion where they were walking away from a group of Samaritans. And we've heard us talk about Samaritans the last couple weeks. There were deep racial tensions between the Jews and Samaritans. And the Samaritans had not responded well to the initial reports of Jesus and the teachings of his message of hope and life and all this. And one of the things John says is he goes, you know, what we ought to do is call down fire from heaven on the Samaritans because they're not as deserving as we Jews are. That's a little bit of a weird thing to say. Another time, they're sitting at a different meal with Jesus, and for the first time, Jesus predicts his death. He warns them that the day is coming where he's going to be sacrificed on behalf of their sins. And it's interesting because the first thing that John says is, ooh, okay, well, when we are in glory with you, can I sit on the right hand of your throne? Like, is this really the time to bring that up, John? That's like someone telling you to have 1 month to live and you saying, oh, dude, when you die, can I have your car? Like, who says that? At the end of John's gospel, he records this scenario when they find out that the tomb is empty. Jesus is alive. Can it actually be true? And he and Peter go running for the tomb. But he makes sure that we know that the one who Jesus loved outran Peter. The one who Jesus loved got there first. The one who Jesus loved stooped in when Peter was too chicken. Isn't it interesting that he had to include certain details about their competitive rivalry? Why does that matter? The answer is it doesn't. But see, John let his confidence morph to some extent into cockiness. John would be, watch this now, John might be the closest thing to a church kid that Jesus had in his 12 disciples. He was probably the only of the 12 that felt like he was entitled to a seat at the table. There were times where, just like you and I, John's pride got the best of him. Jesus knew that. But he still gave John a seat at the table. John wasn't the only one there. You also had one who questioned Jesus. One who questioned Jesus. And that's Thomas, or as you may have heard of him, Doubting Thomas. Now, what's crazy to me about this particular nickname is the fact that Thomas was assigned this nickname that he is still referred to as 2,000 years later because of one incident. How do you like that? How would you like to be labeled, defined, or stereotyped based on one thing that you say for the rest of your life and your legacy for thousands of years thereafter is based on one incident if you don't know the story? After Jesus is resurrected, the tomb is discovered empty. Jesus, in resurrected spiritual form, has revealed himself to a number of people, and the disciples are gathered in the upper room. And somebody tells Thomas, did you hear? Jesus is alive. Thomas refuses to believe. He says, until I'm able to put my fingers in the holes in the hands of my Savior, I refuse to believe that it's really him. Now, here's the thing. We can call him Doubting Thomas all we want, but you can't blame him for being a doubter. Let me give you two reasons. Number one, the people who found the tomb empty in the first place were women. Now, ladies, sisters, don't be offended by this. This was the society, this was the culture of their day. A woman's testimony back then was considered invalid in court. So for the women to come and give the initial report, men were supposed to say, okay, we need to verify it for ourselves before we can believe that it's true. You can't blame him for doubting. Number two, how are you going to blame a dude for doubting that Jesus is alive when nobody's ever seen a resurrected person before in history? Doubting Thomas. It's crazy. The day comes when Jesus walks in and the disciples are gathered in this upper room. He walks straight past the other disciples, goes straight to Thomas. And if I'm Thomas, I'm thinking he's going to bring it up. He knows that I doubted him. He knows I questioned him. He doesn't even bring it up. He just says, touch. Feel. Go ahead. Go on now. I want you to know today, Jesus is not insulted by your doubt. Look at me. Jesus is not intimidated by your questions. If Jesus is insulted by anything, it's your unwillingness to bring them up to him. It's the fact that you pretend like they don't exist because a good Christian can't really doubt, right? A good church-going American can't really have questions, right? Wrong. I wonder if Jesus' posture is the same for you that it was for Thomas 2,000 years ago. Go ahead. Touch. See, Jesus knew that Thomas had questions, but he still gave him a seat at the table. What about this guy? One who denied Jesus. Ooh. I mean, I can understand a brother who's a little bit prideful or a dude who has some questions, right? But somebody who denies Jesus, like, why are you going to give that guy some fried chicken? Like, come on, man. Like, really? That's Peter. If you don't know the story, Peter, who I'm sure you've heard of before, because Peter was at the center of so many incredible miracles that we talk about today. Walking on water, feeding 5,000, countless others. Peter was at the center of them all. In fact, Peter's name wasn't originally Peter. It was Simon. Jesus changed it to Peter because Peter means rock. And Jesus basically is telling him, on you, on the rock of Peter, I'm going to build this thing called my church. But then this day comes when Peter says to Jesus, I would never leave you. I would never forsake you. I'd never, you know, I'm with you till the end, Jesus. And Jesus says, surely you will deny me three times. How many? Not once, not twice, three times. And you'll know, because when you do, you'll hear a rooster crow. The day comes when Jesus is betrayed, he's arrested, he's led off to be flogged and crucified. And sure enough, Peter says, I don't even know the man. He denies Jesus not once, not twice, but how many? Three times. And then he hears a rooster crow. I mean, how could this happen? How could somebody who was so devoted to Jesus in a moment's notice suddenly deny him and run away? Can you relate? You see, no, I've never denied Jesus. Well, maybe you've never denied him with your lips, but have you denied him with your life? Have you professed Christianity but lived as though you're an atheist? Similar to Thomas's story, there's this moment when the very next meal after the Last Supper that Peter eats with Jesus is on the shore of the Sea of Galilee. Peter's back to his old profession, being a fisherman. He's working all night, and he sees Jesus in resurrected bodily form, which is kind of cool, cooking breakfast, cooking some fish over a fire and on the shore, and Jesus calls him over. Now, if I'm Peter, I'm thinking, here comes the I told you so's. Here comes the moment when Jesus says, didn't we talk about this? You denied me. What was that all about? Like, let the lecture roll, right? But that doesn't happen. Similar to Thomas's story, Jesus calls Peter over to the fire and doesn't even bring it up. He just says, Peter, do you love me? And he doesn't just ask Peter this once. He asks him three times. Why does he ask him three times? Because he wants to show Peter that he's reinstating him. What if Jesus has equal measure forgiveness for your failures? What if Jesus has equal amount of grace for your sin? Listen, some of us in here, let's just be real. We are really good sinners, but he is a way better Savior than we are sinners. Amen, somebody. Come on now. So Peter denies Jesus. Jesus knew that Peter was going to deny him, but he still gave him a seat at the table. And then there's this guy, one who betrayed Jesus. Hello. I mean, we've all been a little bit prideful from time to time. We've all been a little bit cocky. We've all got questions, and let's be honest, if we've probably denied Jesus a time or two. But how many can really say they've betrayed Jesus? I mean, that's a bit extreme. But that's Judas. That's Judas. What's interesting is that Judas basically, he sold Jesus out to the Roman authorities for 30 pieces of silver. In U.S. currency, that's about $10. I'm like, can I just ask, is that all Jesus is worth to you, Judas? Is he nothing more than a commodity to be traded? Like, what was this all about? You see, for Judas, he never really understood what this table was all about. He was using this table to get to another table, a table of power and influence, a table of success, status. And he was willing to do whatever it took to get him there. Maybe we could just say it this way. Judas used Jesus for personal gain. Now can we relate to Judas? I think we can. And what's interesting is we find out from one of the four Gospels that Jesus didn't just give Judas a seat at the table. He gave him a seat right next to himself, which is a seat of deepest friendship, intimate friendship, deep honor and trust. Jesus knew that Judas was going to betray him, and he still gave him a seat at the table. What? Here's what's crazy to me. You have four guys with four completely different responses to Jesus, and every single one of them got bread. Every single one of them got wine. Why? It's as if Jesus was saying, my grace is sufficient for you, no matter who you are, where you've been, or what you've done, or even what you're about to do. My love is beyond all of that. He still gives them a seat at the table. He still gives them bread, and he still gives them wine. Here's the one thing that popped at me this week as I was studying the message. You can put that point up. Jesus invites us as we are, but envisions us as we could be. That's good, isn't it? Jesus invites us just as we are, but envisions us as we could be. And here's a question for you. If Jesus is willing to invite to the table one who loved him, one who questioned him, one who denied him, and one who betrayed him, why would you even for a second think that Jesus wouldn't pull out a chair for you? And if Jesus pulls out the chair for them, would Jesus in 2020 pull out the chair for your white neighbor, your Latino, and your black neighbor? I think he would. Would Jesus pull out the chair for your straight neighbor and your gay neighbor? I think he would. Would Jesus pull out the chair for your Republican and your Democrat and your socialist and your fill-in-the-blank neighbor? I think he would. Would Jesus pull out the chair for your Christian neighbor and your Muslim neighbor? I don't just think he would. I know he would. I know he would. That's my Jesus. Here's my question to you this morning, Church of the Springs. Who do you relate to the most up here? Who do you relate to the most? Is it John? Is it Thomas? Is it Peter? Is it Judas? Who do you relate to the most? And here's another question on it. If you relate to one of them, like, what is your next step? As a follower of Jesus, recognizing that he still gave you a seat at the table, what is your next step? What's one thing you can do to say, I'm going to draw closer in an intimate relationship to him. I'm going to press in. And because he loved me first, I'm going to be a better neighbor by loving my neighbors. Here's what I want to challenge you to do this week. Something that's a little bit different, but you know, we're coming out of a pandemic season, and so we got to do things a little bit differently. I so wish that right now I could call the band back out. They could hit some like deeply spiritual keyboard pad that gets up in your feels, and we could send the ushers around to distribute communion, and we could partake of the Lord's Supper together, but that ain't happening. So here's what I want to challenge you to do. I want to challenge you at some point in the next 2-3 days to get around the family table and share communion just with your family, just with your spouse, just with your friends, just with your kids. Like share communion with the people who you do life with every single day. Maybe take some time to explain to them what the sacrifice of Jesus is all about. The fact that he invites us just as we are, but envisions us as we could be. You don't even have to use bread. You don't have to use wine, grape juice for those of you under 21. You don't have to like figure out something creative to do, but share communion. And here's what I want you to do. When you're done receiving the elements together, celebrating the Lord's death and resurrection, I want you to talk about who you might give a seat at the table once this pandemic thing dissipates. Which neighbor, which family could we invite over to build a relationship with, to show them, just as Jesus showed his friends 2,000 years ago, I love you and I invite you just as you are, and envision our relationship as it could be. So when are you going to take communion together, and who are you going to invite after the fact? For some of you today, at all of our campuses, I'm sure that there's somebody going, I don't know, man, like I never really understood the fact that Jesus gave me a seat at the table. I didn't understand that his body was broken, his blood was spilled for me. And listen, it's not too good to be true. It is true. But God will not force you to the table. Do you hear me? 2,000 years ago, he sent out an invitation when he hung on the cross with his arms spread wide as a way of saying, come one, come all. But it's up to you to RSVP. It's up to you to accept the invitation and say, I will sit at the table and die in an intimate fellowship and an intimate relationship with Jesus. Because he's not interested in you just joining a church or joining some religion. He wants a friendship. He wants a relationship with you. And if you've never stepped into that relationship, if you've never had your sins forgiven, you've never been set free, you can start that relationship right here, right now at church this morning. If you're ready to do that, would you just bow your heads with me? If you're ready to make that choice today, you can just pray this simple prayer with me. Nothing formulaic about it. It's just telling Jesus what's happening in your heart. You might say, God, thank you for giving me a seat at the table. I recognize I don't deserve it. There's nothing I can do to earn it, but I accept it. So please forgive my sin. Please put me in right standing with yourself. And please begin changing my life so that I look more like you. From this day forward, I'm a follower of Jesus. It's in his name I pray. Amen. Church of the Springs, can we clap our hands and welcome some new members of the family? Hallelujah. That's awesome. That's awesome. I said this last week. I'll say it again. I made that decision. I prayed that prayer when I was in middle school. Frankly, I didn't even really know what I was getting myself into, but it's been a journey of life change since then. And God has done things in and through me that can only be explained by his presence. And I believe that he's going to begin the same work in your life. And we as a church would be honored to come alongside you in that journey, to pray for you and resource you. Maybe there's some next steps that you can take. Growth happens on purpose, not on accident. So maybe we can help make that happen. So I want to encourage you to take that Connect card that Hal told you about earlier inside of your welcome guide, or you can access that digitally if you're watching online at thesprings.net/connect card. And there's a little box up top that says, I committed my life to Christ. Go ahead and check that, and then our team will get in touch with you from there. Once again, congratulations. That's awesome. Listen, Hal said it earlier. I'm going to say it again. Y'all are crazy generous. You know that? Like, and you got some people seated around you at every campus location that are so generous. And the proof is not just in the food drive, but in what we've been able to do in the last 3 months. So I just want to, you may not realize this, this is our very last weekend of doing the drive-in service outside, and then that big screen, the big billboard is coming down. But I just want to tell you, like, weekly, what we saw God do throughout the pandemic season. You would think that not being able to meet in the building, like, our numbers would drop and people would vanish and it would be a struggle. Can I just tell you that online every single week, on average, we had 2,600 people watching. We had 1,300 in cars, and this one's awesome. Nearly 800 new people checked out Church of the Springs in the last 3 months. Isn't that crazy? And so many of them made a decision to trust Christ for the very first time. And all of that happened. All of that happened because of your generosity. You helped us pivot and make some things happen that wouldn't, frankly, have happened otherwise. So thank you so, so much. I look forward to the stories we're going to be able to tell based on 2020. What a crazy year, man. But I also look forward to the stories that are going to come in the days ahead. Because I know as a church, we're going to continue to be generous. So real quick, if you'd like to make a gift to the Springs today because you believe that we invest well in advancing God's kingdom in creative ways in and around our nation, listen, I want to encourage you to do that by going to thesprings.net/giving. There's easy ways to jump on and automate your giving, text in your gifts. You can do it right there online. A number of ways you can do it. If you have any questions, you can ask any of our staff or volunteers on the way out. We'd be happy to help you with that. Look, we love you guys so much. We're so excited to see you back here next week for 4th of July weekend. It's going to be a lot of fun. God bless you guys. We'll see you next week.
Close. I've been away, yeah, losing my faith, yeah, hope I'm not late, trying to find grace, yeah, for my mistakes, ay, I need to pray, yeah.
hey, yeah, I need to pray, yeah. Wake up to the mirror like, I need you to fight for me when I don't know what I believe, yeah, hey. Why does everybody leave?